Hi, everyone. Thanks for being here. And please welcome Sophie Grace Chappell, who was very gracious to agree to do this talk. She works in ethics and history of philosophy very widely. And she's going to talk to us about chickens, chameleons, and emos. Thank you very much for being here.
Okay, thank you. So I will talk for an hour or so, and then we'll have half an hour for discussion, if that suits. It's a great pleasure to be here. I've never given a paper in Vienna before, in any sense of in. In August, I'm going to be physically present in Vienna for the European Society of Analytic Philosophy, which I look forward to very much. Today, I'm only in Vienna with you in a virtual sense. I'm actually physically in Dundee. I'm going to talk today about, essentially, this is a critique of ethical naturalism in the style of Philippa Foot, Rosalind Hursthouse, Michael Thompson, and others, a kind of ethical naturalism that I've sometimes called, in things I've written, zoological naturalism, a description of it that seems fair to me and wasn't intended to be a polemical label, but seems to have been taken as a somewhat unkind way of describing it by some of the proponents of that position. I'm not sure why they think it's an unkind description. It seems to me fair enough, but anyway. So the way this is going to go is I'm going to start with chickens. We will get to chameleons about halfway through, and emos will be mentioned briefly towards the end. And as you see, and unless I get off course, I will get to all three of those items in the tick list, I promise you. And as you see, a more sober, a less interesting title would be From Ethical Naturalism to Not Just Naturalism. So the basic positive, the negative takeaway of this paper is that there's something seriously wrong with zoological naturalism, something very obviously wrong, really. The positive takeaway of this paper is that there are things in the idea of natural normativity which are worth having and which we can do something with, but we need to combine them with other ethical resources that we have. And that's why the position I want to end up with is not non-naturalism or anti-naturalism or zoological naturalism boo. It's not that position, zoological naturalism, is asserting things that are wrong. What's wrong about it, I think, some of the assertions are wrong, but what's wrong above all about zoological naturalism is the that's it clause, the way it's claimed that we can do everything in ethics on this basis. And those who are familiar with my work as in ethical anti-theory will be unsurprised to hear that what I think we should do with some of the resources that zoological naturalism gives us access to is indeed use them, but not think that they're the only game in town, and try and work out what else we might combine them with, and of course, how. And that's a question. That's the question that we get to by the end of the paper. And if there is an argument from authority here, it is that Alistair McIntyre seems to me to reach the same kind of conclusion, and seems to me to be asking the same kind of question as I am. In particular, how is it that we might combine the resources of zoological naturalism or natural law theory with a phenomenological account of what matters, an account that's based on our own experience? So, to begin, as all good papers do begin, with an epigraph, this is Bernard Williams responding to Martha Nussbaum. Williams said some slighting things about Aristotelianism, Aristotelian neo-naturalism in Ethics and the Limits of Philosophy. Nussbaum, in her essay for this volume of essays responding to Williams' work, and in particular to Ethics and Limits of Philosophy from 1995, Nussbaum tries to present, have another go at presenting neo-Aristotelian naturalism, a position that I think Martha Nussbaum has since moved fairly sharply away from in some ways. She's much closer to being a Stoic in her ethics these days, which of course involves a certain amount of naturalism, but isn't just the naturalism. It's a kind of naturalism crossed with proto-Kantianism or something like that. But at the time when she wrote the essay in World Mind and Ethics, she was advocating something much more straightforwardly neo-Aristotelianism, And this is what Williams had to say in general. The Aristotelian approach takes for granted, against, this is my interpolation, the kind of individualist egoism canvassed in Plato's Republic by Glaucon's challenge. Against that, the Aristotelian approach takes for granted a strong view of the harmony among themselves of human capacities and needs. This assumption does, I must confess, seem to me more plausible if you can help yourself to an Aristotelian cosmology than if you regard it as an open question, whether the evolutionary success of humanity in its extremely brief period of existence may not rest on a rather ill-assorted bricolage of powers and instincts. This is one reason why I still think, as opposed to the emphasis of Nussbaum and others, no doubt he has McDowell rather in his sights when he says others, that it makes a big difference to accepting Aristotle's ethical outlook that we cannot accept his cosmology. And by the way, McDowell seems to be another interesting case of someone who wants to combine, as we're going to find out in the end, McIntyre does, and as I also do, someone who wants to combine the resources of something like Aristotelian naturalism, zoological naturalism, with a much closer attention than some kinds of neo-Aristotelian give to our own phenomenology. So not every creature has reason to live so as to fulfill its purpose in life. Just ask a battery hen. A battery hen's purpose in life is to produce as many eggs at as little cost as possible, then be turned into a raw material of the fast food industry. The resultant misery and distress to the hen is just a corollary of her living according to her purpose, her telos. And a frank egg farmer or chicken farmer might admit that. From the battery hen's own point of view, there's no reason at all for her to live this way. As she would see it, if she had a chance to consider the question, she'd be better off doing almost anything other than fulfilling her telos. The battery hen's telos and her flourishing are plainly not the same thing. Almost all of the time, they don't even coincide. Of course, we can imagine a flourishing battery hen, but that would mean one that had escaped from the battery. That's my first move. Telos and eudaimonia, I'm going to keep saying this, telos and eudaimonia do not necessarily coincide, and sometimes they're sharply opposed. The purpose of a being's life and what it is for that life to be a flourishing life, just they're quite different concepts. There's no reason at all why they should line up. And to that first point, an obvious rejoinder is a battery hen's not living the natural life of a hen. If we want to think about the purpose of a hen's life, we need to look not at battery hens, but at hens in natural condition. Well, first of all, that complaint has a certain irony to it. You might have thought the one thing we do know for certain about battery hens is their purpose in life. We know that for certain because we set the battery hen's purpose in life. And if we were to create, as is created in The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, a kind of meat-producing animal that that is solely exists solely for the sake of giving us meat, then that too would have its purpose of in life as being to give us meat, and that purpose in life would not necessarily line up with what the creature itself wants. Although in the case of the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy example, it does actually want to be eaten. Eudaimonia for it thinks, is being eaten. So there's something obscure about the idea that animals in general have any purpose in life when they live in natural conditions free from human interference. The idea that animals have a purpose in life actually gets its clearest expression in cases like battery hens, where the purpose in life is absolutely dead against the eudaimonia of the being. Anyway, we also need to ask, what are natural conditions? When hens have been extensively domesticated for a very long time now, so your average barnyard hen bears little or no relation to her ancestors in the wild. For a bantam or a Rhode Island Red today, there's arguably no such thing as natural conditions. But sure, there's an intuitive sense in which a free-range hen strutting around a barnyard with other hens, pecking at stones and seeds and other hens, is flourishing more than a battery hen. But that's not a barnyard hen being in natural conditions. It's a barnyard hen in favorable conditions, conditions where she gets to get up to more of what she wants to get up to. A case where we know what natural conditions are and can see, once again, the same moral, that they're not at all the same thing as favorable conditions, or constitute, nor that they constitute, that natural conditions are not the same thing as favorable conditions for this creature, and they don't constitute an animal's freedom to do her own thing. Take rabbits. A wild rabbit's telos, changing perspective, we might say, is to provide predator species like foxes, stoats, and eagles with abundant prey. If that is the telos to the rabbit's life, then the rabbit's flourishing is not the same thing as the rabbit's telos at all. Here we might contrast wild rabbits and well-kept house rabbits. We used to have a house rabbit. She had a great time. Her life expectancy, which we call Vasey, her life expectancy at birth was 10 years. A wild rabbit's life expectancy at birth is 10 months. Vasey lived her 10 comfortable, warm, dry, well-fed, predator and parasite, and mostly disease-free years. Then she died painlessly in a vet's clinic. A typical wild rabbit lives its 10 months average in almost constant terror, hunger, cold, wet, and illness. And then it's eaten alive by an eagle or a stoat or a fox, or eaten alive from the inside by parasites, like maggots. Rabbits are very prone to fly strike. When you have a pet rabbit, you have to protect it from burrowing maggots that live inside the rabbit until they kill it. So that's all natural. All that suffering and distress for rabbits. A house rabbit's life is almost completely unnatural, but that's hardly a reason to think that from a rabbit's point of view, it's any less attractive. On the contrary, if you give any individual rabbit the choice between the withered heath and your living room, suitably predator-proofed, you give her that choice and she will vote with her paws for the living room. And this used to be comically obvious with our pet rabbit, with Vasey. Sometimes she was very keen to go outside and eat grass in the back garden. Sometimes she would scratch at the door and we opened it for her, and it was a howling, dirty night out there, or perhaps there was snow on the ground, and she turned around and lolled back into the living room. She made it perfectly clear that she wasn't for going wild. So one difference between telos and eudaimonia that you might be thinking about here that emerges from cases like these is that while we can to some extent isolate the flourishing of an individual animal from its ecological background, it's harder to do that with an animal's telos. If we can talk about the tele, that being the plural, telos is neuter, if we can talk about individual species tele at all, we need to see them in their environment, maybe to the extent that the telos we're really talking about is the telos of the whole ecosystem, which overall telos acts as a limit both on the tele and on the eudaimonia of particular species within that environment. So we might push the talk of purpose up to the level of the entire ecosystem. And that's what I was already hinting at in saying, well, maybe the telos of the wild rabbit is to be eaten by predators. To push it up that way is to postpone the conceptual problem of the very idea of purpose talk in zoology. But whether or not that's right, in normal zoological discourse, eudaimonia and telos, the eudaimonia of a species, individual species, is much more easily isolable from its ecological background than the tele of the individual species. And here's another case which illustrates this. I think I'll put this quotation up on screen share. So this is about wolves in Yellowstone National Park in the US. When the wolf was killed off in the 30s, the absence of wolves took a huge amount of predatory pressure off the elk. Elk populations did very well. The elk pushed the limits of Yellowstone's carrying capacity, and they didn't move around as much in the winter. They browsed heavily on young willow, aspen, and cottonwood plants, and that was tough for beaver, who need willows to survive in winter. You see, this is all knock-on effects. In 1968, when the elk population was about a third what it is today, the willow stands along stream were in very bad shape. After the reintroduction of wolves, there are three times as many elk, yet willow stands are robust. So there's more elk to eat the willow, and yet the willow are doing better. That's because the predatory pressure from wolves keeps elks moving, so they don't have time to browse the willow intensely. With elk on the move during the winter, willow stands recover from intense browsing, beaver rediscovered an abundant food source. As the beaver spread and built new dams and ponds, the cascade effect continued. Beaver dams have multiple effects on stream hydrology. They even out the seasonal pulses of runoff, they store water, they provide cold shaded water for fish. The robust willow stands provide habitat for songbirds. Beaver dams also act as a filter on pollution. That's worth mentioning, especially in the context of Britain at the moment, where we have a government in Westminster which is entirely happy to see every stream in Britain thoroughly polluted with sewage. But I'll restrain myself from getting political. So in Yellowstone, biologists have the rare opportunity to document what happens when an ecosystem becomes whole again, what happens when a key species is added back into the ecosystem equation. So now we're not talking about flourishing in individual species, except against the background of the flourishing of an entire ecosystem. If we want to talk about the telos of elk, for example, you have to put them in that kind of context. Whereas if you want to talk about the flourishing of elk, it seems you can do that by talking about elk pretty well in isolation, elk against any background context. Elk are flourishing, presumably, if not many of them get eaten by wolves, and if they have lots of comfortable habitats, and if they're not prone to diseases, and if it's easy for them to reproduce, and so on and so forth. And that is flourishing for elk, up to a level in the elk population where it begins to be bad for the elk themselves that there are so many of them. But up to that point, the flourishing of elk doesn't have much to do with the telos of elk. Okay, so that's the first bit of natural history. Here are some provisional morals. First, telos and eudaimonia are not the same thing. And that's partly because of the logical structure of the two concepts. A creature's eudaimonia in ecological isolation is not too hard to specify. Its telos in ecological isolation is very difficult to specify, as the case of Yellowstone shows. If you want to talk about the telos of the rabbit, then you might well say that it's contrary to that telos that Vasey lives with us in our nice warm sitting room and isn't out on the heath giving foxes and cats and badgers and other creatures, eagles, a chance to hunt and kill Vasey, because that seems to be her telos in her ecological niche. There's a difference in logical structure of the two concepts. Eudaimonia seems a much more isolationist concept than telos. And there's a difference in content. Insofar as a creature has a purpose or a function, aside from any that humans or other external agents might set for it, going back to the battery hen, fulfilling the function need not take the creature in anything like the same direction as movement towards a state of flourishing would take it in. So secondly, if we human beings are creatures such that, a population of creatures such that for us, telos and eudaimonia do coincide or come to the same thing, then that is a remarkable fact about us. If that's how it is for us, we're very much the exception in nature and we're extremely lucky. Thirdly, without a guarantee that our telos and our eudaimonia point in the same direction, it looks like we might straight off the bat say that we have reason to pursue our eudaimonia, though you might doubt that too, I'll come on to that later, but it looks like we have reason to pursue our eudaimonia, but unless it's guaranteed that our telos and our eudaimonia coincide, it's not clear at all that we have any reason whatsoever to pursue our telos. Fourth moral, historically the most important way to guarantee or try to guarantee that our telos, the human telos, and our eudaimonia, the human, what eudaimonia is for humans, the most important attempt to guarantee that they coincide is providential theism. That guarantee isn't always in clear display in typical modern expositions of natural law ethics, such as Foot or Nussbaum's. Far from it. Even in Aquinas, whose philosophy is a paradigm of divinely backed natural law ethics, divine law is still one thing and natural law another, yet the two in Aquinas run in parallel. The close association to this day between natural law ethics and influential versions of providential theism, such as Catholicism and many versions of Islam, it's no accident that they're closely associated. If you want to argue both that it's good and right for humans to live according to their natural purpose, and also that so living is what flourishing is for them, then it's not only useful, it might perhaps be essential to that theory, to that argumentative aim, to have God as the ultimate guarantor of this large-scale cosmic harmony. Now, we don't need Darwin to show us that there's a deep problem about reconciling concepts of well-being and purpose in nature, just open minds and observant eyes. But more than ever post-Darwin, our optimistic confidence that the human telos and human eudaimonia go together has got to be shaken. And it takes something substantial like a faith in providential theism to keep the optimism anything like intact. And even then, of course, you famously faced things like the problem of evil. But that's another story. For all these reasons, it's surprising that natural law ethics has sometimes been espoused by professing atheists like Philippa Foot. We might be as surprised as Nietzsche was surprised by George Eliot's ethics. Not that George Eliot's ethics are in any way Aristotelian. George Eliot's position is more like a sort of post-German Enlightenment Kantianism, or Hegelianism, I'd say. So there's this famous passage from Nietzsche, which I won't read through. In England, one must rehabilitate oneself after every little emancipation from theology by showing in a veritably awe-inspiring manner what a moral fanatic one is. That's Nietzsche's comment on George Eliot, characteristically scornful and mocking and with more than a hint of misogyny to it. But you get the idea. But aside from Aquinas and the Catholic tradition and other theistic traditions of ethics, there is another guarantor of the requisite cosmic harmony to whom an atheist like Foote, who is also a natural law ethicist, might look for support, and that's Aristotle. And here we can ignore for the moment, as atheists tend to, the point that Aristotle himself was clearly a theist, and in a sense, a providential theist too. But suppose we put that aside, we get to my fifth and final moral, which is that when Aristotle sets up some terminology in his apparently tedious way in the first book of the Nicomachean Ethics, we all read this, don't we, as undergraduates? We all read this bit of Nicomachean Ethics book one and think, oh, what a bunch of platitudes. How very boring you are, Aristotle. You just say these things. You just line up your Meccano-like terms and on you go with your moral algebra, and it's all very boring. And the main thing that makes it interesting is that you keep referring us back to Plato and that there's something like a struggle going on to try to work out what actually you do mean, because what you say is often quite cryptic. But we've all done it. We've all gone past this bit of early in the Nicomachean Ethics where Aristotle says that the human telos is eudaimonia. The human purpose is happiness, as it's often translated. And he goes on to specify that eudaimonia is the fulfillment of the human ergon or function. And it's a particular kind of realization of the soul in line with virtue. And all of this sounds, as I say, pretty bland and unexciting. It sounds like we're just getting stage-setting preliminaries. But actually, as so often happens when we read Aristotle more carefully, it comes out that actually he's not saying boring things or platitudinous things or obviously true things at all. He's saying something very often, which actually is a very strong and very striking assumption. He just says it in that rather dry lecture hall way of his. And this is a case in point. When Aristotle lines up the human telos, the human purpose, the point of our existence with eudaimonia, with happiness or good fortune or flourishing or doing well in life, however you want to translate eudaimonia, when he makes this assumption that the two things line up, I hope I have shown by now that actually that's a huge assumption and not in any way platitudinous or truistic. Okay, so far we've got the chickens. Perhaps fairly soon we'll get to the chameleons, and maybe by the end we'll get to the emos too. Let me point to an objection at this point. Let me indicate an objection at this point. The objection starts from my fourth moral just given, my assertion that the coincidence of telos and eudaimonia needs underwriting, or tends to need underwriting, by some kind of cosmic optimism, most likely, historically speaking, by providential theism. Now, this assertion can be denied if we take a different notion of telos from the notion, if we take a notion that's different from the arguably polemical and unfair notion of telos that I've deployed so far. Perhaps you're going to say, come on, Chappell, you're cheating a bit. with telos. Maybe a telos isn't just an externally imposed purpose, like God decreeing in Genesis what human beings should do, namely in Genesis, they should go forth and multiply, and they should become masters of the world. But maybe a telos isn't just an externally imposed purpose. Instead, the telos of any animal, we might think, is not top-down imposed in this kind of way. It's emergent from the flourishing of the creature. So what the telos is depends directly on the flourishing, and for that reason they are connected. So a species telos, we'll say on this view, is just its unimpeded flourishing. The two go together. If you visualize that unimpeded flourishing, which you might also note is what individuals of the species typically strive for anyway, then you are already visualizing the telos of that species. And it should already be evident to you too, in what sense that creature's telos is the good for it and is something that does indeed have reason to pursue. So here I'm expounding the views of Michael Thompson or something very like them. And I think there are already in what I've said so far, examples of problems for this kind of view, but let's try and go with it. I mean, one obvious problem is to do with Vasey the house rabbit. What's emergent from Vasey's flourishing? What's the telos that we get to from the way she carries on in a way that she finds pleasant and constructive of happiness for her, which is hanging out with humans, staying warm, getting plenty of food, getting plenty of sleep, getting the occasional nuzzle or cuddle with her humans. How does that fit with what Michael Thompson has to say? Well, I suppose he has to say it something, a move that I've already mirrored early on in the paper, a move that I've foreshadowed already. The move has to be, well, pet rabbits are exceptional because that's not the way that rabbits live naturally. And then, as has already happened earlier in the paper, we come back to the pressure to explain what natural conditions for any species are. And I'll have more to say about that as we go on. So anyway, Thompson wants to give us what he calls a representation of life. And he's emphatic that having hold of a representation of life, that is to say, a brief thumbnail account of the life of some species, having hold of such a representation is not having hold of an externally imposed purpose, such as God might decree for a creature. It's a conception of what it's like when a creature gets on well, which derives ultimately from the creature's own inner causal structure. So we've got in the quotation, which I won't read out, you can look it up yourselves if you like, or find it in the paper. I should have said, by the way, this paper is available online if you go to academia.edu. It's also on ResearchGate. I have a page on both those sites, and this paper is there. Not in quite the form I'm working from today, but in roughly that form. So we have P in order that Q, as a kind of generic, which is going to be true, and is going to be a crucial part of the structure of Thompson's representations of life. And P in order that Q straightforwardly entails both P and Q, and the kind of connections that we're talking about here are cases where P is something like, they have blossoms of such and such type, and Q is so that such and such insects should be attracted and thereafter spread the pollen about. So where P in order that Q is true of some species of plant, then P is true, they do have blossoms of that type, and Q, such insects are in fact attracted and do in fact spread the pollen about. In making out this sort of connection, Thompson says, one links a plain fact, not with a possibly unrealized end, but with another plain fact. Natural teleological judgments may thus be said to organize the elements of natural history. So I do think Thompson is onto something here, perhaps not quite what he thinks, but certainly something. We look at nature, we try and understand it, and understanding nature does indeed consist in representation of life. In Thompson's sense, it does indeed consist in, amongst other things, of course, in deriving statements of this P in order that Q form. Natural teleological judgments organize the elements of natural history. They articulate the relations of dependence amongst the various elements and aspects and phases of a given kind of life. And this has nothing to do with divine purpose. Even if God himself, the divine mind, were to affirm for himself P in order that Q statements, it wouldn't be his decision that they should be true. That would be what makes them true. They're true in virtue of the order of nature. They're not true because God asserts them. They're true because of the order of nature. Of course, God, being the creator, would be in a position to bring about the state of affairs where they're true. But even then, it's not because God asserts them that they're true. It's because he creates a world in which they're true. So that's what Thompson has to say. The representations of life that he's talking about are just these P in order that Q kind of statements, and the larger structures of explanatory narrative about zoological species that we might build up. And about such explanatory narratives, there's a kind of what is often called Euthyphro structure. I don't actually believe that the dialogue, the Euthyphro, does contain what's called the Euthyphro dilemma, but the terminology is now unfortunately well concreted into our normal thinking, and it's what we've got here. These P in order that Q statements are not true because God asserts them. They're true, and therefore God asserts them in reflecting on how things are in creation. God may have created creation, but it's not his asserting these representations of life that makes them true. They're true because of the order of nature. So there's a kind of Euthyphro structure there. All right, so we can see that kind of teleology of nature in this imminent way. We can see it as emergent bottom-up from the creature's pursuit of its own eudaimonia, and therefore not even potentially in conflict with that eudaimonia in the way that a transcendent top-down imposed teleology might be, and not only in battery hen cases. However, I begin to have this feeling at this point, and I think you should be beginning to get the feeling too, that there's been a bit of a case of a swap out here. The claim that we needed to combat was the claim that telos and eudaimonia get separated from one another because of factors in the ecological situation, for factors about, for example, predation, disease, parasites, and those kinds of factors. Those are the kinds of factor about telos that make telos difficult to state for individual species without introducing concepts from the wider ecology. It looks as if Thompson has ceased to fire at that target altogether. He's firing instead at a target to do with divine decree as a way of shoring up teleology and telos. And we can grant him the point about teleology till we're blue in the face. That we can grant him that there's a sort of Euthyphro structure to that problem, but we've changed topic. That wasn't the problem that we were addressing. The problem that we were addressing is the problem I've already raised about ecological balance. So suppose the telos of a rabbit or a hen or an elk or a wolf is what Thompson's argument about representation of life suggests it is. It's not. The telos is not the animal's function within the overall ecology. It's the animal's what the animal does instinctively to survive and reproduce, and what it's inclined to do and will do if unimpeded. If so, then not just the telos of any individual animal, not even the telos of any individual species taken on its own, will be enough to give us any clear normative guidance at all about what we should promote or preserve or prevent in our interactions with the natural world. So the point here is we can divorce telos from the wider ecology, if you like, in the way that Thompson is perhaps suggesting. If we get Thompson back on track, stop him talking about divinely imposed decrees of teleology, if we get him back to talking about the conflict about between telos and eudaimonia that I was addressing before, then perhaps Thompson is saying that the telos is what a being does to survive and thrive and reproduce. Then that takes us further away than ever from the notion of anything like overall normativity. The telos of any individual animal, so understood, won't be enough to give us any clear normative guidance at all about what should promote or preserve or prevent in our interactions with the natural world. Hens peck seeds, elks graze saplings, rabbits breed like rabbits, wolves eat the lot of them. In Thompson's sense of telos, as now understood, we can't read an environmental ethics, let alone an ecological policy, off any one species' telos. what we need is a conception, the telos of the whole ecology. But the whole point of going immanent on the notion of telos is that this is precisely what such a notion isn't. It's not a conception of the telos of the whole ecology. His description of the blossoms refers to pollen, and that implies a reference to pollinators. But that aside, each and every time Thompson presents a representation of life, he's talking about the telos of just one species considered almost completely in ecological isolation. And he's followed in that. Thompson's influence on Foot and Hursthouse and other proponents of zoological naturalism is very striking. That one paper of his, The Representation of Life, seems to be an absolute smash hit, first with Foot and then with Hursthouse. And one is left scratching one's head a little that it's had quite this amount of influence, that single paper, especially when I think I'm arguing here that there are very serious problems with the argument. One problem is just a kind of charismatic megafauna bias. It's the wolf and the elk and the beaver that these writers talk about. They don't take mosquitoes or slime molds or bacteria or tapeworms as their examples of species form, even when they talk about plants. They don't talk about giant hogweed, that poisonous plant that overruns riverbanks in Scotland. They don't talk about Japanese knotweed, which is a real problem to householders because it actually undermines buildings. Even when they're talking about plants, these people talk about pretty flowers along the riverside. They don't talk about beetles even, for which Haldane famously noted the Almighty's inordinate fondness. Their conceptions of animals can often seem, frankly, more like a medieval bestiary than a modern zoology. Lions, for instance, for these writers, are noble and chivalrous beasts, the kings of the savannah, as brave and majestic as Aslan. There's something going wrong here, and I think, in a nutshell, it's inadequate zoology. And if we apply all this to humans, we still get the problem that this conception of telos doesn't may be engineered so that it doesn't conflict immediately with eudaimonia, at least for the species considered in isolation. But we're steering away from anything that could be of use in practical normativity, in ethics. We're steering away from that because we know, for example, what we humans are inclined to do and what we instinctively do when unimpeded. We know at least roughly what eudaimonia looks like for humans. But when you consider the state of the world today, it's not altogether unnatural to wish that human beings were less successful, not more, in pursuing their telos and their eudaimonia, where telos is given a broadly Thompsonian interpretation. If the human telos is seriously comparable with animal tele, in the way that zoological naturalists characteristically insist, then the normative force of considerations about human eudaimonia can't be the foundation stone of a theory of normative ethics, especially not all on its own. On the contrary, that normative force, while it's not nothing, and I want to stress that, I'm not saying that there's nothing here. I am saying there's not enough here for such considerations to be normatively decisive. And come on here to the notion of natural defect, which Foot in particular makes a great deal of. A wolf that hunts alone, she says, a bee that doesn't pollinate flowers, a mother lion that doesn't look after her own cubs. Such creatures are defective relative to their species. You can get that on Natural Goodness, page 30, for example. Now, Foot acknowledges that there's the problem about how to make the transition from zoological assessments like these to the moral assessment that a human who lacks the virtue of justice is also defective, and Foot spends a lot of time trying to deal with that problem. But although Foot deals sensitively and at times successfully with those problems, the problems during the transition to humans and after the transition to humans, the real problems have already begun before. Because there are many regularities in species that we might well want to call species norms, given how endemic they are, and yet which don't look at all well fitted to the normative role that Foot wants to give them, even when that's only a natural normative role, which is Foot's terminology. She thinks she can contrast natural normativity with moral normativity, and her big headache is how to get from the one to the other. And I'm saying the problems are already there with the natural normative notion. And there's an example right under Foot's nose when she's talking about lions. The main threat from which a lioness needs to protect her cubs is adult male lions, non-alpha males, who characteristically, and neither nobly nor chivalrously, and not at all as Aslan would do, they kill lion cubs whenever they get the chance. Now, you can explain that behavior very easily with a bit of evolutionary genetics. It's to do with freeing up the lioness to carry their genes rather than the alpha male. And if you're wondering what my source for these remarks is, I'm afraid it's nothing elevated like nature. It's simply watching David Attenborough documentaries. Lions do this. Non-alpha males regularly and routinely kill or attempt to kill lion cubs. That's pretty much a species-wide pattern of behavior. Why isn't it a species-wide norm for lions that a lion that doesn't try to kill lion cubs, a non-alpha male lion that doesn't try to kill lion cubs, ought, you might have thought on some other parts of the foot count, ought to count as a defective lion? But clearly we don't want to say that, or at any rate Foot doesn't want to say that. Nor would we want to say about humans who find themselves in a somewhat analogous situation, that it's normal for them to threaten the offspring of their sexual partner. But that happens in our species, and it's clearly a pattern. Stepchildren are routinely under serious threat from their stepfathers. That happens, I'm afraid. And as I say, there's a good evolutionary explanation for it. The behavior is instinctive, hardwired, and species-wide, certainly in lions, perhaps in humans too. If you like, then it's natural. But we'd have to be a fairly far-out kind of Nietzschean to think that the cub-killing lion's behavior is the behavior of a flourishing lion, or that such behavior contributes to lion flourishing in general, or that a lion who does not slaughter cubs is indeed, as Foot theory seems to imply, defective. Let alone the analogues to those remarks about murderous stepfathers. It's strange, isn't it, that there's this trope in fairy stories of the wicked stepmother. It's actually the wicked stepfather that is the sociological reality. Alas, in both cases. Though there are norms that don't seem to be norms that we want. We don't want our net to catch them as norms. They're regularities amongst species. We don't want to catch them in our net when we're trying to do natural normativity Foot style. As I say, this is before we even get to moral normativity. We don't want to say that lions, non-alpha male lions killing cubs is a norm for that species because it looks so morally worrying. Perhaps that's the reason why we don't want to say that. So not all the regularities are being picked up in the way we might expect. There's a kind of arbitrary discrimination going on amongst the norms. Well, arbitrary zoologically speaking, not arbitrary at all, perfectly understandable from a moral point of view. So that, I think, is a clear indication that this kind of basis is not going to give us what we need to do ethics. And that may not mean that we need to abandon it wholesale. I'm trying to suggest that we can do something with natural normativity, but there are serious obstacles and indeed alarming problems in the way, just because of the pervasiveness of norms of behavior which aren't beneficial or nice at all. Another point is that species change over time. That's a truism in zoology. And they don't just change over evolutionarily long periods of time. Species sometimes change very quickly and in very short periods of time. So, for example, the New Caledonian crow, Corvus monoduloides, the New Caledonian crow recently, thanks to the activities of tireless ornithologists, it got a new part to its behavioral repertoire. It learned these crows, this is an experiment in, I think, New Caledonia, conducted by Australian scientists. The New Caledonian crow learned to shape a piece of paper into a token and slot it into a vending machine to buy a piece of meat. Crows can learn to do this, and when some crows do, other crows learn to copy them. They'd obviously never find paper or card in the wild, said Dr. Gelbert, so they developed this vending machine that they could drop small pieces of paper in to release a treat. You have to convince the birds, but once they've learned how the machine works, they learn the behavior of using the slot machine to get a treat, and they spread that behavior. They teach other birds the same. So what's to say about that? We might say that the behavioral repertoire of this population of crows has changed. If the learning spreads far enough, we might say that the behavioral repertoire of the entire species has changed. Actually, there's a reason why we shouldn't say that, because this kind of evolutionary change does not take the species as its unit, it takes the population as its unit. Actually, the notion of species as distinct from population has little, if any, genuine role in modern zoology, for good reasons that I perhaps are familiar to you, and I won't rehearse here. What matters scientifically is not the species, but the population. That's partly because populations are much clearer distinct entities than species are. And it's also true because species can exhibit phenomena like ring species. So what one species on one side of the world goes by insensible gradations to another species on the other side of the world. And that just suggests that there's something wrong with species predications altogether. So behavior changes within animal populations, and changed behavior produces new species or population norms. And that, of course, is how evolution happens, or it's one way it happens. There was some first fish that flopped ashore and began to use its fins to propel itself along the Devonian or Cretaceous beach. It may have been a defective fish in Foot's terms, but it was also a non-defective proto-reptile. And there was some first wolf that slunk into the firelight to sit with the humans. If you like, that was a defective wolf, but it was also a non-defective proto-dog. There was some first bird that laid its egg in the wrong nest. That's natural normativity at work again. And thereby got some other bird to do the work of feeding and rearing its chick for it. And that bird may have been a defective bird of some other bird species, but it's also a perfectly good proto-cuckoo. So cases show that populations of animals change their behavior over time. They do that for lots of different, more basic reasons, including, DNA mutation. Also, simply intelligent creatures are adaptive. They adapt their behavior to new environments or new situations. And they really intelligent creatures are not only adaptive, but also instructive. They can teach each other this new behavior, and that's what the New Caledonian crows do. Perhaps it's what the defective wolves did when they first began slinking into the firelight to sit with the Neanderthal or Pleistocene humans, whatever it was. Perhaps they taught other members of the wolf pack to do the same. Certainly they taught their puppies to do just that. And in these ways, species change, and eventually, through genetic mutation allied to behavioral change, you get something that we think it worthwhile to call a different species, namely the dog. And that case is, of course, particularly interesting when we think about the contrast between natural conditions for an animal and unnatural conditions for an animal, which was urged as an objection right at the start to my very first example, the battery hens example. When you think about dogs, I think I'm right in saying that biologists, zoologists, now take it to be correct to say of dogs that they are a symbiotic species who live in symbiosis with us, with the humans, and that their whole pattern of life is geared, amongst other things, to pleasing, placating, ingratiating themselves with, and frankly, flattering humans. This is why, evolutionarily speaking, dogs are such charming companions, why your dog is always pleased to see you and always has a lick for your face and a wag in its tail when you come through the door. It's because dogs have evolved to please humans. That's what they do. That is their ecological niche. So how are you going to claim that this is an unnatural thing that dogs are doing? It's what's natural for dogs to butter us up and get us to give them treats. So to say it again, species norm and species tele change over time in response to the emergence of new and more successful behavior patterns and to changes in the external environment that are decisive in settling which behavior is or is not successful. So you're doing quite well as a wolf in the woods. You manage to get a meal of slugs and snails every 2 weeks or so. Not all your wolf cubs die. But then new factor in the environment, some nomadic humans come into the area and you work it out that if you spend time with them, you as a wolf can do much better. You can get much more food, more of your puppies will survive, and so on and so forth. That's difference in what behavior for you and for other animals in your population is going to work, is going to be successful. Teleological judgments about of the representation of life form that Thompson advocates, they may have merits about particular populations in particular conditions, but first of all, they're not representations of life are not representations of the life form of species, but of populations, and the life forms of populations, the life styles of populations can change over time and do change over time. Moreover, such judgments, despite the claims that some people make about them, don't have some sort of special epistemic privilege. So there's a strain of thought amongst zoological naturalists. Thompson buys into this idea, Foot buys into it, Jen Fry buys into it, in the volume for which I originally wrote this essay, which was Natural Law and Its Problems, or some such title, edited by Tom Haidinger fairly recently. People in this line of philosophy in the natural law school are prone to say things like, well, there's a special status to generics about species. They have a special epistemic privilege. They're particularly clear and intuitively obvious to us. That's, I think, is all just untrue. Such statements are as fallible as any other statements. Remember, in the Middle Ages, people used to believe that barnacle geese grew out of barnacles which grew on the undersides of the leaves of trees and somehow produced barnacles. These were form of life judgments, and they were, obviously and flatly completely false. And there were cases, very common cases, where, whether you like to call it a folk judgment or a judgment of folk science or a judgment of simple science, something like a form of life judgment is routinely and confidently asserted and is in fact false. And here we get to chameleons, hooray. We've got to the second element in my title. We all think, or lots of us think, or I used to think, or everybody thought until 2015, that chameleons change their color for camouflage. That's actually false. That's a piece of representation of life level belief that is just wrong. And here, is the correct explanation. Where did I get this from? From something called the Dodo, an online magazine called the Dodo. Chameleons change their skin color for two reasons. First of all, thermostatically, because darker shades absorb light better than pale shades. And secondly, to do with their moods. They darken their colors when they're afraid. They brighten their colors when they're happy and excited. And males change colour more often than females, who tend to use more subtle cues to communicate, and so on and so forth. Chameleons do not change colour for camouflage. That's the upshot. That isn't why chameleons do it. So intuitive common sense and traditional beliefs about teleology are not just normatively indecisive for the reasons outlined above, but because the teleology of a species often conflicts with the teleology of some other species, and secondly, because there's no isolating the natural for any species in a neat way. The cases of pet rabbits and of dogs show that. And thirdly, because such beliefs are not epistemically privileged. They can be wrong, as I believe about chameleons are. And fourthly, because what's correct to believe about teleology can change over time. We may think, for example, that crows are incapable of teaching other crows to use slot machines. We may have that belief. It might seem a reasonable thing to believe as part of our representation of life for crows, but in fact, that belief can be shown to be mistaken in the light of scientific evidence. So traditional representation of life beliefs that fail the test that I've been setting so far forth, I wanted to say that any representation of life beliefs have some normative weight, but not a great deal, not a decisive weight. There are also representation of life beliefs that have no normative weight at all, and that's just because they're wrong. They're simply mistaken, like the barnacle geese belief and like the chameleons change colour to camouflage themselves belief. So would that be like talk about changes in animals' behavioural repertoires when we see them for the first time? We can, if we like, describe them as defective relative to the species. To a wolf that goes loner instead of hunting with the pack, we might call that defective. We might call an unmotherly lioness who just lets her cubs be eaten by the non-alpha males. We might call that defective. We might call the first cuckoo, the very first animal in history to display cuckoo behavior. We might call that defective. Or again, we might say that non-alpha males that behave less like the non-alpha males in David Attenborough nature documentary are more like the non-alpha males than Simba and actually protect lion cubs rather than trying to eat them, or at any rate to kill them. We can call all of those defective if we like, but we might also call such deviations from previous norms rebellion, invention, and in the right cases, even progress. It can happen that humans find new purposes, and when they do, those new purposes often look defective relative to the old norms for our species. That may be because they are defective, as the cub-murdering lion perhaps is, but it may also be because there's something wrong with the norms, and perhaps not just with these norms, but with any idea of species norms of settling anything like completely how we should conduct ourselves in life. So it happens a lot that humans, or at least some of us, find many kinds of morally loaded disquisition on the human purpose little more enticing to or inclusive of ourselves than the battery hen might find what the egg farmer has to say. Anyone who, like me, is both bi and also transgender and has heard what the Vatican, for instance, tends to have to say about people like me will know what I mean. We may have wondered why our kinds of alleged deviation or defect from the Vatican's species norm of family life are so swiftly condemned as objectively disordered, while those deviations represented by asceticism and celibacy and being a hermit, those kinds of deviation are not condemned at all. What justifies the ascetic and the celibate in traditional Catholic moral theology is that they're kinds of moral pioneer or special agent, exceptional cases because they perform an exceptional service to society at large. But if that's true of them, is it so unimaginable that it might be true of other non-species normal lifestyles as well? It's not that no argument can possibly be mustered to answer this question in defense of the traditional attitude to, for example, transgender people, but it is that it's hard to see how in the end such arguments can avoid a kind of circularity. We allow some deviations because they're the good deviations, meaning the deviations that we allow. It's hardly news that arguments based upon the norms of nature can be deployed for all sorts of contradictory purposes. And that is no surprise, I want to suggest, in the light of the plethora of things that the norms of nature or the regularities of nature actually turn out to be. And in light, too, of the bricolage of incoherent powers that Bernard Williams talks about in my epigraph, it's hardly surprising that you can use norms of nature talk for all sorts of purposes. If slavery is endorsed by great zoological naturalists like Aristotle and Aquinas, then why not by modern zoological naturalists? And incidentally, in the case of slavery, we see arguments on both sides. If you've never read or come across the wonderful tract De Indies concerning the Indians, the native Amazonian Indians, native Amazonian peoples, of 1539, a Salamancan Thomist called Francisco de Vitoria, he gives us a comprehensive and careful scholastic argument of a form that Aquinas would have recognized against the enslavement of the native peoples of Latin America by the Spanish conquistadors. And the argument roughly is that there are only four grounds on which you could justify defeating the natural right of these human beings to be free. And those four grounds are sinfulness, secondly, not being Christians, thirdly, being mad, or fourthly, being feeble-minded and of low intelligence. But De Vitoria says neither, and this is controversial in his time, neither being sinners nor being non-Christians is a sufficient reason for enslaving anyone. There's no general right to do that. And as I say, in the time, that's a controversial thing to say. And for the third and fourth ground, well, of course, the native Americans are not mad, and nor are they systematically feeble-minded. So there's nothing wrong with their rationality, not at any rate anything that isn't also wrong with the Spaniards' rationality, and so there's no undefeated nature-based argument for enslaving them. And you still get that kind of argument. I'm coming now to the end of my paper. We still get that kind of argument in later debates about abolitionism in Protestant Northern European societies 250 years later. Apologists for slavery in America in 1780 are still insisting on the low intelligence of the slave who live on their plantations. They're still insisting that that low intelligence is the intelligence is the crucially relevant natural fact. And of course, it's neither a fact nor relevant. One wonders how bright these apologists for slavery would look if they were suddenly translated to the bottom rung of a West African society, especially if they just spent 2 months in the hold of a slave ship, wallowing in their own shit and surrounded by people dying of starvation and thirst and of diseases. Abolitionist campaigners like Thomas Clarkson are still insisting 250 years later that it is the rights of nature of which the African slaves in the US have been unjustly deprived. So there are still appeals to nature being made there. And I want to say, remember, I'm not completely against natural normativity. I want to say that such appeals have something to be said for them. But of course, the appeals to nature are used on both sides. And that's part of the problem about such appeals, that they so easily can be. Alongside the time-honored appeal to nature at the time of Clarkson, there's also an appeal to what I'll call moral phenomenology, moral experience. And there's a remarkable passage in the preface to Thomas Clarkson's essay on slavery, which you can Google if you like. I got hold of it when I was writing Epiphanies. And this is actually one of my examples of Epiphany. In 1785, Thomas Clarkson wrote this, originally a piece of mere intellectual jousting. He was supposed to write a Latin prize essay, a prize essay in Latin for Cambridge University. He wrote an essay against slavery, and his Latin essay against slavery won the prize. And he went and delivered this in Cambridge, and he was walking home afterwards. Sorry, he was riding home afterwards, and he sat down and had a crisis of conscience. He describes something very like what Quaker abolitionists like John Woolman describe, an uneasiness of conscience, an uneasiness of the moral faculty within us, which is something that Woolman believes in. We have the ability to be wounded in our conscience, to be full of the thought, the guilty thought, that what we're doing or what we're allowing to be done to other human beings is somehow terrible and needs to be stopped. We need to repent of it and change it. This is couched in writers like Woolman and Clarkson in religious terms. It's seen as an experience of grace, of divine grace, that you come to see the truth, the ethical truth about other people. And you come to see that you're complaisant in a practice which is very badly wrong, deeply and seriously unjust, and contrary to God's law, and that you need to change your ways and get away from that. And this is a radically different kind of argument. So what I'm suggesting towards the end is that I'll sum up and stop, I think, and give you a chance to ask me some questions. It's a natural part of our human nature, not only that we live in certain ways and not other ways, which enables us to make something of the notions of zoological natural normativity that Hursthouse, Thompson and Foot want to play with, but it's also a part of our nature that we have the ability in our ethical experience to engage in judgments of conscience. Now, I don't want to reify the conscience. I don't want to say that there's this moral organ within our heads called the conscience. I want to say something a lot more distributed and careful about what the conscience is. But I will say this much. We are typically capable of sympathy and empathy with other human beings. We're typically capable of getting an understanding of what it's like to be them. And that understanding what it's like to be them can be a very stinging and profoundly hurtful experience for us, precisely because we realize that these others are in severe pain, pain in which we are in some way complicit, and that we need to do something about it. This is the kind of thing that happens when our conscience is brought into the story, it's a story about how our natural experience of the phenomenology of the ethical life is another kind of resource that we have in thinking about things like slavery or battery hen farming or whatever it may be, or how to manage Yellowstone National Park. And I want to close with the question that McIntyre is putting in this paper in the European Journal of Philosophy from 2010. McIntyre, you'll see when you look at this, has moved a long way from the McIntyre of After Virtue. He's no longer saying that anyone, as he seems to be at times in After Virtue, that anyone who isn't a kind of Aristotelian naturalist is just, they've just lost their moorings. They've just lost their grip on what it is to be an ethicist at all. They're just confused. He does still say that we find ourselves at the end of a long history during which the relevant set of norms had lost whatever it had once been that made those norms compelling. We started off with something like a Thomist account of human nature. We end up with phenomenological techniques and phenomenological awareness. And in this wonderful essay on Lerstrup and Levinas, McIntyre is scratching his head a bit about how to make these two resources point in the same direction and work together. He's no longer simply dismissive about the phenomenological. He thinks that he does still want to say that the phenomenological account that I've been gesturing at towards the end in talking about Clarkson and Woolman, he does think it's some kind of a report of a historical residue, what remains when some larger scheme for understanding the moral life has lost its credibility. But he still thinks that we need to address it, whatever it is that we've got there. And he still thinks that it has an independent contribution to make to understanding ethics. And that contribution, I wanted to suggest in closing, stands alongside the contribution to ethics that we might get from thinking about Thompson style representations of life. The two things stand together as resources that we can appeal to, as questions that we can ask. McIntyre's closing question is that he's scratching his head about how to combine these two items in our moral moral awareness. And I guess my response is that I wonder about that too, but I'm not as convinced as some other kinds of ethicists, more systematically inclined than me, might be. I'm not as convinced as they might be that we need a neat account of how to combine those different ethical resources. They don't fit together neatly. And maybe, I say, as an anti-theorist, maybe that's just life. Maybe life is not as neat as systematic ethical theory. Thank you.